It's a great privilege to introduce Professor Mattias Kumm, who will give us a keynote lecture now. Mattias is a professor of law at New York University. He also holds a research professorship on global public law and is the managing director of the Center for Global Constitutionalism at the WZB Social Research Center in Berlin, and is a professor of law at the Humboldt University, also in Berlin. And it was a positive surprise for me to see today that this is one person, because when I always heard about Mattias Kumm and what he is doing, I always thought that it must be two persons. Now I know that it is one person. So Professor Kumm studied in Kiel, Germany, and Paris 1 Sorbonne, and he wrote his doctorate work at Harvard University. He has held professorial appointments at Harvard, Yale, and the European University Institute in Florence. He is also the founding editor and the editor-in-chief of the journal Global Constitutionalism, and on the editorial board of ICANN and various journals and professional societies. And he's teaching and researching on philosophy of law, European comparative constitutional law, and international law. And especially his writings on the idea of Socratic contestation and the right to justification impressed us very much during our work on our project, and are the main reason why we thought of the idea to ask you to give the keynote lecture here.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here, even though I'm slightly resentful of having been put at the 5 o'clock spot, which a colleague once advised me is a wonderful time to be very short and entertaining, and given that it's difficult for academics to be entertaining, the easiest way to do that typically is to make a fool out of yourself. Outrageous thesis, I'll try to avoid that, even though there may be some here who think I might have chosen that strategy. So, the title of my talk is Rights Proportionality in Courts Under Some Unfavorable Circumstance, Under Unfavorable Circumstances, Some Observations on History and Judicial Strategy. And what I want to do is just explore three facts or three claims about proportionality-based rights review by courts. First, I want to make a claim about the historical circumstances in which it arose. Secondly, I want to then emphasizing that the circumstances under which they arose, favorable circumstances under which it arose, in many jurisdictions no longer pertain, so that there is a serious challenge to what might be the political or social presuppositions for the successful institutionalization of this type of judicial review. Secondly, I want to say something about how specifically a form of judicial review which connects the analysis of rights to proportionality as a general matter is particularly affected by this type of challenge. And then thirdly, say a couple of things about how a court might be well advised to try to address the tensions that it will invariably be facing in that situation. Much of this is, in particular the last part, hasn't evolved much beyond throwing out some observations and some thesis. So this is very much an introduction to discussion, as much as it is as the presentation of a process of long research and thinking about the issue. Okay, so to begin with about the historical context in which judicial review emerges. Judicial review emerges exclusively in contexts where the main parties which are candidates for potentially forming a government or being a leading part in a government are ones that effectively embrace the underlying principles of liberal democratic constitutionalism. So to give you just some examples, and I want to use the examples of Germany, the United States, Britain here. So in Germany, the Weimar Republic, of course, knew no significant judicial review. It played a very peripheral role. There was some jurisdiction with regard to some limited issues, but generally there was no practice of judicial review of rights in Weimar. And of course, that's not surprising given the deeply contested nature of the Weimar Constitution. There were so-called parties derided by other parties as system parties, that means parties in support of the system, that fundamentally, notwithstanding internal differences between them, supported this type of democracy as the right way to go. And then there were many nationalist, authoritarian, and later also fascist, and certainly also socialist, various forms of socialist and communist positions, which ultimately accepted the Weimar Constitution only as a modus vivendi. It's something, because you're not powerful enough to overturn it and establish something else, you accept it and use it as a framework within which you fight, in part through legal means, in part through organizing of informal violence. You try to bring about change. So in that type of context, this is not the type of context in which judicial review has a chance to have a foothold. Now, after 1945, with the enactment of the Basic Law, and of course by the time the court emerges with the authority, with the jurisdiction to review in the 50s, the situation is very different. First, on the conservative side, it has become unacceptable to be a conservative and a nationalist authoritarian, let alone a fascist. That doesn't mean that there weren't nationalist authoritarian or even ex-Nazis involved in the government in various ways and in the ministries, they were. But in terms of their political persuasions and in terms of their ideology, they had remained silent. They could not articulate it. It was not regarded as publicly legitimate. So they were, in that sense, if you were a conservative and you were to count as a legitimate actor within the system, you had to basically subscribe to a version of liberal constitutional democracy. And of course, on the left, a similar evolution had happened. So the Social Democrats, as the main party that had electoral support, by the early 1950s enacted a program, the 1953 Godesberg program, which basically said, look, we're not into class struggle anymore. We have our constituency and we do think there is injustice being done to them, but we're not going to, in the end, work towards the expropriation of all capitalists. What we're going to work for is adequate participation within economic structures, strong labor movement, strong social security state, etc., etc. So taking a strong, and from contemporary perspective, still quite radical, but nonetheless a reformist orientation, giving up on all kinds of revolutionary ambitions and moving towards moving beyond some version of liberal constitutional democracy. So in other words, it was a situation where, notwithstanding the peripheral existence of a communist party and even a fascist party, the NPD, which were then prohibited by the court, which was possible in the German constitutional law, but they were peripheral. They played no significant role in the politics at the time. So it's probably plausible to claim that at that time there was an overlapping consensus amongst the competing political forces that some version of liberal constitutional democracy guaranteeing the rights of citizens and of those subject to the jurisdiction of the state was an appropriate way to struggle for power and to struggle for the right kind of policies. So that's the German context in terms of the emergence of a consensus. Now, in some sense, that was not surprising and quite conventional story, but what about the United States? Now, here it seems to be a little different because judicial review already emerges in some form in the early 19th century with the decision of Marbury v. Madison, in which Chief Justice Marshall claims judicial review is possible and appropriate under the American Constitution. But if you look more closely and ask, well, what role does rights adjudication actually play in American practice during this time? The answer is none. The first decision on rights, Marbury versus Mervyn was not about rights, it was about competencies. The first decision on rights that the Supreme Court, the first time the Supreme Court struck down a provision grounded in rights was Dred Scott v. Sanford, the decision where the court protected the property rights of slave owners, which had found themselves in a non-slave jurisdiction and then returned to the original slave state. So protection of property rights, here the slaveholder. We'll come back to this decision because it's interesting also for reasons that that are relevant for the discussion of judicial strategies later. So that was the first decision, and none followed for a long time. There wasn't much happening even after the Civil War. So notwithstanding the changes, the constitutional amendments that were made, the clauses were very, the relevant clauses were, this is the conventional and I think correct view, mainly gutted, so that there would be very little room for judicial intervention. The court gutted them, and the court didn't want to get into this business. And when it started doing it again in the late 19th century, it led to the series of cases that are now known as the Lochner series of cases, which is again about the protection of property rights and rights to contract against progressive legislation, which tried to implement minimum hours and minimum wages, maximum hours legislation, this type of standard reform legislation, which was struck down on the grounds that it violated property and contract, right to freedom of contract. So at the time that in Weimar, when the discussion was should Germans introduce constitutional rights, there were all kinds of reasons in the end why they decided against it. But one was to point to the American experience and reflect on it and say what a disaster it was. So there was a comparative angle, and the position was the last thing we want is something to happen like that. And so it was one of the reasons that was rejected. So when we think about the U.S. Supreme Court and the development of modern constitutional rights jurisprudence, we really focus, even though of course there were things going on in the meantime, we really focus on the Warren Court. So the time from 1953 to 1969, and it goes on until perhaps the 80s, early 90s. And if you ask, what is characteristic of that time? The answer is, there is a new post-war consensus. The court could become engaged and ambitious exactly at a moment when it was clear after the New Deal and after the war, after the last Democratic president from the Democratic Party, so after Truman had to retire after his 8 years, and now a Republican one, Eisenhower. Yeah. After it was clear that Eisenhower would ultimately not roll back the whole New Deal, and that he would articulate his policies and his new orientation on the basis of a consensus background, a set of consensus background assumptions, it was that moment which created the confidence, I believe, for the court to start playing an active role. This was a time in American politics where, at least amongst elites, notwithstanding, of course, the story is complicated. There were presidential candidates very soon thereafter on the Republican side, which were quite radical, but they were not successful, and they didn't really have a chance, or they were widely thought not to have a chance of being successful. So there was a sense, a belief, that there was a solid consensus shared by reasonable people across parties on the basis of which the court could articulate its own understanding of rights, and which was generally favorable towards the recognition of such rights. Britain is an interesting story. Many would say, of course, they haven't introduced judicial review properly so-called up to this day because they have a weak form of judicial review which only allows courts to declare legislation to be incompatible with rights without striking it down. But notwithstanding that fact, that is a big shift towards keeping courts out of the business of making judgments on legislative acts generally. So if you ask when did that happen and why, well, it happened in the 1998, and there were two things which had to happen before this was even imaginable. The first was that basically Margaret Thatcher had to radically reform the Conservative Party to move it away from basically a privileged country club kind of class-based countryside anchored party, and the Labour Party had to be modernized and give up on its radical transformative socialist agenda, which was embodied then in the famous clause 4 of its constitutional statute, which called for the expropriation of all means of production for the workers to own it, so to be first of all to be public, to be made to and it was Blair in 1990, shortly before the elections, a year or two before elections, when he became Labour leader, to amend that and to signal thereby clearly that Labour's reform agenda no longer included that. And thereby both, so we have in Thatcher and Blair two actors which I think played a central role in the emancipation of the British political system from its class-based and class struggle-oriented political culture, which lasted longer. So Britain is in many ways, having grown up there, I have an inside perspective on it, is a remarkably, I thought, a remarkably reactionary class-based system right until the early 80s. It's still more than many other societies, but it's changed, it's shifted quite radically since then. And I think this had to happen before it kind of become even plausible for courts to play a role, and not to be perceived as straightforward a political actor aiding one side or another side. Okay, now there are similar stories that could be told about France, where judicial review in practice emerged quite late. Really, even though the groundwork was already laid in the 70s, but it really took off only in the 80s. And if you ask what happened there, well, it was a time when it was clear, it was Mitterrand, who was elected on a radical socialist agenda, failed in a very short time, and then from 1983 he was forced into a cohabitation arrangement with the conservatives, and thereby gave up, basically, on the idea that socialism stands for a radical transformative agenda, and therefore it was, again, there was a way that the varying positions that existed in France appeared to be defined by what Rawls called reasonable disagreement among persons sharing an overlapping consensus grounded in basic principles of constitutionalism. Now, of course, if you're a sociologist, you will always point, there's a certain reductivism and there are idealizations to these types of accounts, but they reflect, I think, basic structural shifts that we need to take account of if we want to explain the emergence of judicial review. Okay. Now, the second point relating history is that arguably we're coming to an end of the period that we can describe in that way. And in particular, and here there is no symmetry, it has to be said, there is no symmetry, at least among liberal democracies outside of South America, between left and right. The real challenge are right nationalist authoritarian populism, a form of right nationalist authoritarian populism. So there are populism can be all kinds of things, but the specific features that I want to focus on in a moment that describes these movements are not shared by, say, for example, Syriza in Greece or Podemos in Spain, so movements or political parties that are also described as populist and that they self-describe themselves even as populist, but they don't share the core features that I think are the challenge to constitutionalism that characterize the right-wing version. So what are those challenges exactly? Now, of course, when you look closely, these if we look at the results and if we look at the persons embodying them, from Putin in Russia to Erdogan in Turkey, to the European versions in Eastern Europe, whether it's Orban or whether it's Kaczynski and or the Polish Peace Party, or whether it's Trump. There are significant variations between them. They have different policies, different priorities. They're different enemies, if you like, different opponents. But there are some basic structural features which I think it's plausible to claim that they share. And the first is, and here I just basically repeat what my Princeton colleague Jan Werner Müller has analyzed more extensively, they are anti-pluralist in the sense that they believe that that the authentic people, the real people, understand who the real leader is and who the real what the correct view is, and pluralism, disagreement, is a sign of decay and corruption of some sort. So if you are not, if you don't see things correctly in the view of that you are taking, if you don't share the view of the right party, the leader, then there's an indication, not that you reasonably disagree with them because you know, you reflect on things differently, your background is different, whatever the case might be, that explains the type of disagreement that we normally think is normal in democracies. The problem is a different one. The problem is either there's corruption in play, so elites are corrupt, or they are treasonous and subscribing to some kind of globalist agenda, or they are they're not really part of the people. They are part of those who somehow claim to, who happen to be in the jurisdiction of the state, and some of them might even have citizenship, but they are not really part of the people, the authentic people. So this is kind of a basic set of ideological tropes which have a certain internal cohesiveness, which in constitutional terms leads to the following type of attacks and the following type of concrete threats. First, whenever such a government is in power, you will see them doing what they can to ensure that the channels of political change get blocked as much as possible in favor of ensuring the status quo of being in power. Which, of course, if the background ideology is that the opposition, as opposition, is not really legitimate, probably, is understandable. So what matters here is to ensure that the right outcomes are reproduced, and you do that by, and there are various strategies you might go from gerrymandering strategies to ensuring that dangerous candidates are off the ballot, so registration requirements, which then push certain people off the ballot, to, of course, the domination of the public media, you must control that, as well as threatening oppositional figures in all kinds of ways, journalists and others using the criminal law and public prosecutions to at least build up a kind of a threat scenario for certain types of committed critics. So that's the first type of thing. So threats to the democratic infrastructure that normally ensure an open kind of an open contestation between different views that then allow one party to win and another to lose, and those who lose accept the other government as legitimate, but they also accept the opposition to what they do as legitimate. So this kind of structure tends to get undermined. Secondly, what you see is a disrespect for the separation of powers more generally. Now that's also not coincidental. Populists do not, they are deeply opportunistic with regard to their approach to institutions. So they don't. It's not procedure that legitimizes anything. Outcomes need to be legitimate. So classic is Trump's answer to the question whether he would accept the outcome of the elections, last elections, yeah. And he said that depends on the result. And that's in some sense it's a joke, but it also reflects a sensibility which denies the very possibility of legitimation through procedure. It's basically the outcomes are what matters. And we know what the right outcomes are. What that means is Even though there is a certain emphasis on such things as elections and referenda, so direct forms rather than indirect forms, ultimately the perspective is an opportunistic one. If elections provide the wrong outcome, as we've just seen in Istanbul and Turkey, you know, there's got to be something wrong with the elections. How can that be possible? That election that we're not... So this, but this is important. This is not an accidental corrupt thing. It's built into the thinking, into the ideology of this type of authoritarian nationalism. So, with other words, separation of powers and respect for the interactions of different institutions, which each assuming their own role and leading to a legitimate response, that will also be threatened. As will, thirdly, the idea that it enhances rather than undermines the legitimation of the democratic process to have voices present and have actors weighing in who are not part of the national citizenry. So think about international civil society, NGOs that are active. Think about the role of international law, if you're in Europe, the role of the European Union as playing a presence, as a factor in elections. All of that will be discredited and thought of as basically external, illegitimate intervention, and there'll be legal ways, there'll be a search for ways of making that stop or making that minimal rather than structuring it adequately. So that's another typical focus that you see. And fourth, what you see is, and if the idea is that there's, that really, if things go well and if we're not in a condition of decay, there ought to be something pretty close to a consensus among the true citizens. That creates a pressure towards homogeneity for which there needs to be a basis. The basis can't just be, you know, under a Kantian conception of citizenship, it's really those who happen to, in the long term, reside in a territory within the jurisdiction of a state ought to generally and normally be the citizens and to be treated as citizens. If you believe, you know, if consensus is what you need to produce, then something more demanding is clearly necessary. And then the focus is on the shared, whatever it might be. It varies from cultural context. So sometimes it's ethnicity, sometimes it can be religion, it can be culture. Whatever it is, that there's an insistence on the importance of a factor of what in Germany is discussed as an issue of Leitkultur, kind of a leading nationally specific culture that is carried by the authentic people, that becomes that comes to the foreground. And the practice of that is very often to enact effectively discriminatory laws against those who are not deemed to be part of that group. So you have that type. This was a typology of four types of threats, two basic features of the liberal democratic constitutional order that we currently see wherever nationalist authoritarian, where these groups gain power are in government. Now we come to the role of courts, and particularly the role of courts engaged in rights-based proportionality analysis. The first thing to note is how such courts are in many ways in the particular precarious position. Compare courts that engage in some idealized form of, ideal-typical form of proportionate rights-based proportionality analysis to a court that primarily engages, for example, in originalist analysis. So let's say your understanding of the rights guaranteed in the Constitution are all, it's really about the original understanding. The original understanding interpreted as the understanding as it existed with regard to concrete expected results. So if that's the orientation, then a judge who makes a decision with regard to an issue can always say, yeah, whether you like it or not, I might not like it either, but you know, there you go. It's change your Constitution. It's what can I do? So the judge presents him or herself as just following through on a command that was given by the constitutional legislature and basically claims not to be making an independent judgment at all. Now, we know that know, there are all kinds of things that are deeply problematic about that characterization, even within this framework, but there is a way in which it rhetorically functions and works, and thereby has a tendency in these tough situations to create a safety net for a judicial institution. What about, then there are other ways courts can try to, there are other approaches, more conventionalist approaches. So what my colleagues call living tree approaches, which actually in the Anglo-Canadian world counts as a hallmark of liberal openness in many ways, is of course a deeply conservative metaphor, which ultimately insists that adjudication has to take part within the bounds of what is conventionally accepted and what has historically evolved, and which is also where traditions and what is accepted plays a significant role for determining how we should understand the principles in the Constitution. So it's not uncommon. Think about, for example, the European Court of Human Rights that does this on a regular basis. When it asks how should we understand, say, freedom of religion in a particular context, when it decides how seriously it will look at the justifications of public authorities, or how large the deference, the margin of appreciation will be, it basically asks how widespread of a consensus is there on this type of issue. And then there's kind of a, you know, then if there's a dominant consensus, then the court will say, okay, then we really take a close look. And then actually presumptively we will strike it down. But if there isn't, if there is deep diversity as a matter of fact, there's no consensus on this issue, then that is a strong presumption for the court to back off. It will just not really engage in careful analysis of proportionality. Now this is the underlying theory behind it is a conventionalist theory of law. So the authority of law ultimately relies on what is conventionally accepted. And when we have these open clauses like freedom of expression, freedom of association, this is the type of thing that from the perspective of a court, you should only give concrete meaning to if the meaning that you give to it is sufficiently supported socially and politically. Otherwise, you should back off. So that's, if that is your view, if that's your approach to adjudication, then of course the possibility to be in significant tensions with the powers that be are also reduced. You have options to say, I'm just doing my job, and under the circumstances doing my job means I step back because there's no solid conventions that I can go on, etc. So these are approaches which whether sometimes linked to proportionality or not, of course the ECHR is an example of a conventionalist, I would call it a conventionalist court. It's oriented towards the enforcement of widespread conventions. The only reason it has any edge at all is that there are so many different states that are part of it, and it sometimes happens that there is a majority of one kind that requires other states then to engage in progressive reforms. Generally speaking, we see here a combination of proportionality analysis, which the court does make reference to on a regular basis. It's a standard way for it to engage public authorities, but it's tempered by a doctrine of margin of appreciation, which basically leaves the court toothless in very many situations, where according to this third view, that I will now come to the genuine rights-based proportionality view, it should act. So what is that? What is distinctive about that third way? And here I want to first say something, before I want to highlight why it's an approach that is particularly threatened by authoritarian nationalism. I want to kind of highlight how the role that proportionality plays within it. Because of course this isn't just about proportionality. Proportionality appears in the context of a legal framework before a court in which individuals typically, not necessarily, but typically, bring claims that their rights are violated. And they do it in a legal framework which validates the foundational significance of human dignity or equal liberty or something along those lines. There's variance across jurisdictions how this is done, but typically the idea is that fundamentally what we are doing is we are analyzing whether actions of public authorities are proportionate with regard to how this individual is concretely affected, and whether it's justifiable to a position to somebody, and an action by public authorities is justifiable to this individual, so that that person can understand what is being, what he's suffering or she's suffering, as something that nonetheless takes him or her seriously as a free and equal who is part of that community. So that's the normative framework within which we use proportionality. That's what gives it its normative power. As I said previously, I am serious about the claim that that Mr. Schacht could have also used proportionality, and that Stalin could have used proportionality as a way of rationalizing and structuring economic and industrial reforms in their respective times. It's just a rationality criterion which can be embedded in all kinds of deeper normative structures. But the point is, in the context that we are analyzing it, it is embedded in a very distinctive normative structure which insists on the ultimate, as individuals endowed with human dignity, understanding themselves as free and equal, as the foundational idea that guides and constrains, not just constrains, also guides actions of public authorities. So it's within that context, when we then use proportionality, that it has its distinctive bite and its distinctive significance. The problem with courts doing what they are doing is the problem of Socrates. That's why I call this approach Socratic contestation, but I really mean that. It's not just a little lawn literature game. There's something deep and substantive about that claim. And here's the Socratic puzzle. Socrates was told by the Delphic oracle that he's the wisest man living. And most people think, as does he, how can that be? I know nothing. I'm not qualified as any, he was a craftsman by trade. I'm not qualified in any particular way. I don't claim to know anything much, specifically. So how can that be? And then he goes around to prove the Delphic oracle wrong. He goes around and asks people who have a claim to knowledge and authority on, you know, how they know what they know and how they know. And it turns out very often, just by asking questions and then assessing the answers, that many of those pretenses are built on nothing much. That very often those who claim to know something actually turn out not to have a solid foundation for claiming to know something. But the thing is, the Socrates of the early Platonic dialogues is somebody who doesn't present theories of his own. He has no theory of metaphysics, no theories of justice, no theories of anything much. What characterizes him is the insistence on asking questions, on demanding justifications for claims of authority of others, and assessing them, seeing whether they're plausible, whether one can believe that or not. And in many ways, I think, when an individual goes to a court, the way that doctrines have been rearranged by courts that use the proportionality analysis, proportionality analysis typically comes in cahoots with a whole bunch of other doctrinal shifts. So typically the scope of a right will be expanded expansively, so that an individual that is burdened in any meaningful way is likely to be able to have a rights claim. It's likely to be claimed that there's at least an infringement of a right. Furthermore, it's likely that over time there will have been that standing doctrines will have opened up the court to a person making this claim. It's also likely that a court will insist that every issue is at least in principle justiciable. So the whole idea of political questions and limits of justiciability tend to disappear. And that is what happens. That is when you take seriously the idea of rights-based proportionality review as a form of Socratic contestation, as a way of giving individuals the possibility through the court in a public procedure to contest claims of authority, because of course laws claim authority over you, they require you to comply with it, then there's a possibility to ask for justifications. And if the justifications provided by public authorities in the end don't pass muster, then the court can strike down the relevant actions as unconstitutional. And the proportionality test in this structure has the function to provide a checklist of mutually complementary, in that sense it makes sense to speak of an integrated approach, mutually complementary but nonetheless distinct, individually necessary and collectively sufficient tests which decide whether or not an action is justifiable in terms of public reasons. I mean justifiable to persons who understand themselves as free and equals. That's the function of proportionality tests and constitutional adjudication as I see it, and that's the wider idea underlying it. If you ask what's the moral point of a practice that has this structure, then I claim it's to institutionalize this form of contestation. Now, the dangers of this form of practice is that judges ultimately get the same question as Socrates did. So there was a Socratic, there was the at least the Delphic oracle who said, you're the wisest man, and then you have to go out and see what could possibly ground that. Of course, normally there are instances of kind of self-empowerment of judges, of courts, but mostly the standard way this is done is through legislation, through constitutional legislation or other legislation. Courts are empowered. That's like the Delphic oracle. It's just all of us, courts are supposed to, you know, play that role. You have the final say. You have the final say to decide what counts as law in this jurisdiction, what can claim legitimate authority over citizens and what can't. And the question is, if judges are not simply craftsmen of the law, if they are not primarily persons who on the grounds of established authority, at best apply and maybe on the margins interpret existing positive law, if they do something else, if they engage in this type of Socratic contestation, and have something like the proportionality test, which just establishes certain basic criteria of rationality that then public authorities have to meet, on what basis can they claim to play the role that they play? So it didn't end well for Socrates. He was convicted by a jury of his peers. And was forced to and was sentenced to death and then had to kill himself. And now the question is, do we have reasons to expect courts to fare better, these types of courts to fare better in an environment, the type of environment that I've described, or perhaps less dramatically and a little bit more focused, we might ask, what is the best strategy? What is the best way for a court to deal with a situation where it is subject to this type of threat? Now, here, to begin with, there are two very basic positions one might start off from. One position is, and this is a position that in the end I will argue for, though I'll then qualify it at the margins. One position is, it really doesn't change anything. Basically the judicial equivalent of John Wayne's "A man's got to do what a man's got to do," is a court is there to perform a particular function. Its function is to protect rights, and it should just do that. To the best of its abilities, using careful analysis, applying the proportionality test as it demands to be applied, and then make its conclusions and decide the case as according to the best light of the respective justices it ought to be decided. Full stop, end of story. So that's one basic approach. That approach can be contrasted to a different approach, which suggests that what a court needs to do in this non-ideal constellation is to perpetually find itself making judgments in which it has to balance, on the one hand, The loss of its integrity or the reduction of its integrity through accommodation and complicity with legislation that it doesn't strike down, or acts of public authorities that it doesn't strike down, even though it might have thought it had reason to, for political reasons. So on the one hand, you know, the loss, both in terms of not protecting the rights that they ought to protect and what it means for the integrity of the court. On the one hand, against the fear of dismantling or backlash of various kind that it would otherwise suffer if it upheld, if it did follow the John Wayne approach, and then, you know, maybe go under in a blaze of glory, but maybe go under. So we have the business as usual approach, and compared to that we have the, let's call it the fight for another day approach, or the strategic retrenchment approach. So it's one where sometimes you will do something, but you be careful, and you'll be, you know, you are very attuned to the political context in which you're in. Now, the way you would do it within the proportionality framework is you just blow up deference doctrines. That's basically what happens. What judges committed to this type of approach, how they would doctrinally, concretely do it. So the margin of appreciation, or whatever the name of the relevant deference doctrines will be, that will be defined in a way that it doesn't lead to inconvenient results that would endanger the court in the eyes of the judges. That's an obvious way. The more traditional ways of justiciability doctrines and the narrow scope of rights or standing requirements, that tends not to be the direction courts go. And I understand there are different reasons why that might be. It's more obviously reactionary. You're going back to, you're reinventing something that you got rid of, that was getting rid of at some point. So that's less likely, arguably, to happen. So the focus is likely to be on deference doctrines. Now, I find that deeply unfortunate, because when a court says that something falls within the margin of appreciation, then it's effectively saying that the actions taken by public authorities is legitimate. It was taken within the powers duly conferred by the Constitution to it. That's what the court is implicitly saying. Now, talking about legitimization, this is the worst form. This is the most direct and the clearest form of it. I think this makes courts deeply corrupt institutions. It's not the right way to go. It's smarter to use other doctrines, avoidance doctrines, where ultimately the court is not on record for having pronounced itself at all on the issue. That is a better step. It's still, the result is the same. It'll be upheld as law. So the person won't be helped whose rights are violated. But at least the court has not endorsed political position as one that falls within the powers of the government. It merely has said it's not its role to say anything about the issue. So these kinds of avoidance doctrines, like standing and jurisdiction and justiciability, as unattractive as they are for other reasons, have that advantage. They make the court less complicit the actions of the government that it feels it can't do anything about, it should not be doing anything about. But I think all of this is the wrong direction. The court should do neither. Should neither expand the margin of appreciation for opportunistic reasons relating to its self-preservation, nor go back to any of these types of doctrines. Why? I think if there's anything that we can learn about judges from the history of adjudication, is that they are terrible at striking these kinds of balances. Once they try to go down that route, if we established an anti-canon, the kind of decisions that we think are the most terrible decisions that judges have made in the history of adjudication, they're all statesman decisions. They're all these decisions where the court thinks it's a savvy actor in a complicated political context, and for that reason decides to step back. So here, Dred Scott v. Sanford, that I first mentioned, the 1857 decision, which many say accelerated the path of civil war in the United States, was a decision where Chief Justice Taney, who wrote the decision, believed that what he was doing was kind of pacifying the country and settling an issue that he knew would create a great deal of tension and pressure, and the way he thought you have to keep the lid on, you have to keep the lid on, and that's why the decision has to go this way. What actually happened was that that even though there was some thought about it in exactly that way, it was not, as we know, how things went. And it was simply a wrong calculation, a wrong reading of the situation. And instead of punishing Taney for that and saying it was a bad reading, we should generally ask how confident should judges be in reading reading the situation more generally. And it turns out, if you go, and I would like to, I haven't done this myself, I just, my own analysis of this has been restricted to the jurisdictions that I'm familiar with, so mainly the United States and Germany. But there really is a strong connection between the most plausible candidates for the anti-canon, so the decisions that today there's most consensus on that they were terrible, and judges trying to play a strategic role and holding back with their power. So in other words, the historical record suggests that courts are bad at this and often act counterproductively in that context. So that's one argument against that. But that's of course still a pragmatic argument. It depends on whether the empirical claim, how good judges are, is true or not. I think it's plausibly true in most contexts, but I don't think ultimately my position depends on these empirical contingencies. I think the argument is much simpler, and it is that the institution is likely to fare, well, there are two ways. I could again frame it as an empirical point. I could say the institution is likely to fare better in the long term if judges insist on doing their job as they should. If they don't do that, that will, the danger and the effects that creates on the institution, the way it corrupts that institution, will likely have a more dangerous effect than the other way around in the long term. So it may well be that in the short term something happens, something may happen to the effectiveness of the institution. Maybe the judges will be replaced, maybe the court will be abolished, maybe there'll be constitutional changes made that effectively strip the powers of courts in some way or another. For example, there are different ways of doing it, but perhaps even through the introduction of a notwithstanding clause or something along those lines. So the possibility for an ordinary legislature to basically overrule a court. There are all kinds of ways this can be done. But the answer to that is, well, you know, let it, you know, that if it happens, that must happen. Fight it politically. Don't fight it as a judge on the court. That's not your job. On the court, for so long as you are on the court, for so long as you're a judge on that court, you have a job to do. And if the rules governing your activities change in a way that it becomes incompatible with this idea of what it means to be a judge, then you've got to resign. If the political backlash consists in limiting or structuring the judicial role in a way that it can't effectively play the role, can't in its basic function the way that a court should, if it becomes de facto a legitimating device for the government and little else, then there's no longer a justification for keeping the position as a judge, or at least it's a virtuous, it's the right thing to do, arguably, to step down. So, does that mean now that there's a dogmatic position of business as usual? Never ever adapt. Never don't go. Don't cede an inch, etc. There is something. There is a way in which the context matters for the practice of adjudication, but it's not to step back, and it's not to. But it is to be attentive, and to be careful, be aware of what you are doing. For example, there is a danger particularly if there's still a strong culture, as there is arguably in the United States, and as there certainly is in Germany, and I hope that will remain the case. But if there's a culture of a certain, these are liberal elites, that are confident in themselves, they can be too glib in the slapdown. That means they will strike things down, or they will say things that, in the concrete case that they are dealing with, won't do justice to the issue that they are dealing with. They do not have the patience, and they do not have the empathy to do what normally a good judge would do, which is to make the case and carefully analyze the situation. So this is now a point about, I can't remember his name, Bass, who made earlier, professionalism.
Bass.
So yeah, there you are, yes. Yeah. So remain professional. And insist on, be careful, because there might, you might be wrong, or that you might have missed an angle that somehow you would have good reason to integrate into a judge. And maybe you might even revise your original inclination that just because it comes from this type of government, you might not have a reason to strike it down. You've got to be careful there. You shouldn't cede one inch. So the point is not to not strike something down because you're afraid of the consequences, but the point is to, notwithstanding the fact that there's a deep dislike and a certain understanding that the government in power has deep anti-constitutionalist commitments and is in some sense an enemy of the Constitution, that should not affect your judgment on the individual case that you're adjudicating. You've got to remain professional in that regard. So that's an important point, I think, governing judges' behavior. And the second one, it concerns timing. I do think it's not inadequate, though that may be contested. There are certain things that I think judges may judge to be wise to keep off the agenda for a year maybe, or 18 months, and others that they might prioritize and highlight in a particular situation. I think this type of, most judges deal with crowded dockets. They have to make decisions what they prioritize and how. And I think a calculus of when something, sometimes it's useful that something is hotly debated to decide the case, sometimes it's dangerous to do that, to make these types of judgments. Judges make them all the time anyway, but I think that's perfectly fine. That's the type of judgment I think that judges rightly make, and I think these types of decisions gain particular significance in contemporary times. But finally, and this is now a more technical point about proportionality, but an important one, I think there is a value in emphasizing more the basic categorical commitments connected to proportionality-based rights adjudication. Because it's not all about balancing. Balancing is often important, and in some jurisdictions that's where cases are mostly decided. But even when they're mostly decided there, the way it's decided there is often because some other things have long been ruled out as legitimate. So, to give you an example, a contemporary example, the WTO, a WTO panel, has just recently ruled that when an actor, in this case it was a case between Russia and Ukraine, but really in the background was Trump, so when the panel made this decision they were thinking of Trump, when as a justification for limiting trade, a national security is invoked, then it's not enough for that reason to be simply invoked, even though the language in the GATT reads as, it says if the state deems this to be, so the language is such that it suggests an interpretation that all a government has to do is to say it's national security that justifies what we do, and then that's it for the court. It should back off. And the panel said no, even when we're dealing with national security, and we know it's not our task to second guess, we don't know too little about national security's issues to play an active role in reviewing substantive decisions relating to national security, but we have to have assurances, and we have to gather from the context, and proportionality will here help, to see whether it was a claim plausibly made in good faith. And if it's not made in good faith, then it won't stand. Then it doesn't justify, then it's basically, then we know it's protectionism Then it's just an invoke. You can't. So Trump invoking, this is the context, he's invoking, seriously invoking national security exceptions in the context of spare parts for cars and the importation of cars.
Vis-a-vis
Canada, but it's also on the cards for a wider range of jurisdictions. Yeah, that's right. So it's in your face ludicrous in many ways. So the question is, how does the law deal with it? And the WTO panel, which is existentially threatened by current U.S. policies, just says it doesn't matter. We're not going to get actors, we're not going to let them get away with it and claim that this is okay under WTO law, and the panel decision signs off on it. We will not sign off on it. And they were right, I think, to say that even if the consequences, even if this may encourage some in the Bush, but some in the Trump administration to act in a way which basically effectively shuts down the WTO as a dispute settling institution for the time being. So, what does it mean? So, it means that the court, the panel here, said what we want to make sure is that we know this isn't really about a protectionism in trade, because that's categorically prohibited. If somebody says, we want to protect our industries, that's why we're doing it, well, that's not a permitted reason. And the same is true often in law. So, think about a classical ECHR case dealing with gays in the military. So, this was an old case in the 1990s. ECHR case, the court immediately looked at the justification that then the government provided, which is all about combat cohesiveness and combat effectiveness. Of course, there's a legitimate grounds. That's a legitimate reason why you might restrict who gets into the military. When you then analyze step by step whether this meets the proportionality requirement, the answer doesn't. That's a legitimate purpose, but it doesn't. In the end, there are alternative means available, and on balance, there's no justification for that. The court decided this, I think, rightly. But what the court might have done more than courts have until recently been willing to do is to just explain. To say, okay, the government is saying combat effectiveness, etc., and that we will have to analyze closely because that is a legitimate purpose. However, what we should be clear is what is not a legitimate purpose is to exclude gays because it is deemed to be a national honor to serve in the military service, and it is not, and the gays are not worthy of serving in it. So make explicit what the range of possible purposes that might have played a role in the background, or that some support. Just say, if it was this, certainly we know, and we're just clarifying that. We're not suggesting anybody had that purpose. But we're just saying that these are illegitimate purposes. These are categorically ruled out. These are not reasons to restrict rights. But of course, there's something left, and then we have to take seriously, and that we really have to analyze carefully. And I think courts normally don't emphasize what is ruled out. They very quickly just jump, say, there is a legitimate purpose because it could be this. So another case that is a relatively controversial case involving the criminalization of incest. Now, there are most forms of incest are criminalized without specific incest legislation because they involve minors. But this involved a case of a brother and a sister in their late 20s and 30s. They hadn't actually met each other before their 20s. They grew up separately, and then they fell in love at the funeral of their mother. And then they had a family, and then they were criminally prosecuted on the grounds that they were brothers and sisters. And the question is this justified? And there are whole kinds of reasons why there were reasons invoked relating to typical power imbalances, psychological between these types. There were public health grounds relating to the health of offsprings. The thing is, you can, once you take all these reasons seriously, they don't amount to a justification for reasons I won't go into. There was a consensus, in fact, at least in German court, that they don't amount for a justification of incest, for a prohibition of incest. But what remained in the end, and what the court couldn't shake off, and it actually mentioned, even though it did not dare say, that it legitimated it in and of itself, it was not a legitimate reason, is that there's widespread social support for the categorical prohibition of this type of thing. People don't do it. That's the moral conviction that is widespread. It's not primarily about preventing harms to others, or there is a deep sense that this is there's something wrong and distasteful about this, and therefore it shouldn't take place. Now, the interesting point is, of course, this is exactly the type of justification, an ethical condemnation of how somebody goes about living their life, using at most the consent of others to join them. That's exactly the type of reason that's not legitimate. And so the right, if a court were to, so that's morality legislation, straightforward morality. Not public morality. That's again, that's different. How you appear in public, and there's at least something to balance, arguably. This is about morality of how you live your life, also in private. So this is the type of thing which arguably is simply not a legitimate reason to. And the court should have been, even if it came to the conclusion that it did, it should have been clearer from the get-go to say, well, if it was just that, this thing alone is not a justification for the limitation of a right. There has to be something else. So, with other words, emphasize what a serious commitment to the rights within this liberal democratic constitutional tradition, what it amounts to, the categorical. Emphasize it. That doesn't mean you're not going to do proportionality. You're just going to emphasize in the first prong what you're not really looking at because it's excluded. But that's, and then you can still say, well, you know, there's a legitimate purpose in play here, as most of the time there is, but it just turns out that that legitimate purpose very often doesn't justify the measures taken. So emphasize that. I think it's important to emphasize that, to drive it home. And secondly, I believe it's smart for courts to embed their reasoning, embed it more strongly than perhaps they have traditionally within this tradition, done, or at least sometimes they're actually doing it, but scholars don't highlight it. And that is to embed their decision-making more strongly in the idea of a coherent set of other decisions already made, so a culture of precedent. Not in in what I think is the pathological way the US Supreme Court does it, basically substituting the justificatory analysis by jumping around between different kind of precedents, but by saying, look, we've decided a lot of things relating to these issues already. We've decided this, and this is established now, and we've decided this. And if we take that as a baseline, then it seems that this type. So, with other words, this provides a grounding. This provides a stronger grounding of the concrete decision in decisions already made and accepted, where that's possible, which I think is likely to strengthen the court in these types of, in the kind of environment that we're currently facing. So there too, kind of also an attempt then to ultimately spell out the decision that the court reaches in the form of a doctrinal rule. So, with other words, emphasize more strongly that even though proportionality is kind of the background structure, this is a structure that ultimately justifies rules. When we ask what rules does it justify, we can see that there's a certain kind of coherence that transcends the case and that transcends the free reasoning of that proportionality analysis appears to suggest. It's kind of embedded. It's embedded much more in an existing legal context, which makes it seem more lawyerly. Now, this is something that actually courts often do anyway, but we should, as scholars, understand that that's going on and that courts do that, and rightly do that, in part to deflect exactly the type of criticism that they're likely to get in that when they apply proportionality in the present context. So, with other words, no stepping back, so holding the line, business as usual, is in many ways the right way to think about it, but some flexibility on timing, an insistence on professionalism in the sense of also testing the boundaries of your own comfort zones, taking seriously what you're hearing even from others that you're deeply skeptical of, And third, highlight the rule-like, the categorical elements of the proportionality test. So that would be, those would be my suggestions to put forward to discussion. And I have a wonderful round here to do that, because I know that's obviously there's some very experienced and high-level judges sitting here, and I'd like to hear how what they think about these proposals. So thank you very much.
I would like to thank you for a very timely and relevant lecture.
Actually, too
and,
timely.
And
too timely?
Too relevant.
Yes. And I think if you looked at the audience, you had a very attentive audience of those the hours, although we started at 5 o'clock, so we did not...
Sorry about that.
...not do justice. So the floor is open for comments and questions.
So thank you. This was very interesting. I have many, many comments, but in the interest of time, I will just note two. One, I think the issue, at least in some of these populist scenarios, is you mentioned the loss of consensus as a social consensus as an element. I think there is also a sense in some countries that they are on the cusp of attaining a permanent political majority. And in a way, cutting down the courts, marginalizing political opposition, media, etc., is a way to entrench power. I mean, you don't do this in a scenario where power shifts, because you may be on the receiving end on the other, after the next elections. But if you're sufficiently confident that you're going to win every elections in the foreseeable future, then the political stakes are very different. And then you are seeing the courts not as some merely as a nuisance. There is a very different logic. So it could be part of the move to authoritarianism, but it could also be the result of having no longer a competitive political environment. So I wanted your reaction to this. And secondly, one of the proposals that people like Samuel Moen are putting on the table is that rights are not popular enough because they do not appeal to the masses, because the rights project has been emphasizing certain elitist, high-income appealing features, and that we should actually go to push towards expanding the universe of rights. Like, for instance, Moen talks about social and economic rights, doing more work on poverty, etc. And I am somewhat skeptical of this, but I would want to hear what your thoughts about actually not circling the wagons, but actually opening them up and making the case that this rights discourse would be beneficial to larger groups of people than currently is.
Shall we collect? This is what we're going to do, and
because we won't have much time. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So first of all, thanks.
I wanted to make a defense for deference. You want to blow it up, and I just wanted to say that there's a particular way...
No defense of deference. Deference that is ultimately justified with reference to the political environment.
Yes, so this one. There's a particular way in which the European Court of Human Rights has acted recently, and it's interesting. In the Hearst decision on prisoner voting, it kicked the ball back to the democratic bodies with respect to its sort of engagement with the rights question. So it said we could defer here, but in fact, you haven't discussed this for 150 years. Now, another way that you could characterize that kind of kicking of the ball back to the democratic bodies is meaningful engagement in the South African context. So you don't go you don't just say it's all within your competence and the case is closed, but you start this sort of back and forth relationship by saying you need to engage with rights. You, the democratic body, needs to engage with rights, and if you do, we might be minded to step back from this decision. So this is one kind of way that you might influence the otherwise rights skeptical, rights violating debate. And that, I just wondered whether that was being taken into account in that context.
Yes.
We'll take one additional, then you will respond.
I just want to tell you, Mattias, it was wonderful, what you said, because it's exactly what is happening in this country. And secondly, it is exactly what crossed my mind. Because, and I talked about it in the morning a little, because on this background, the question I am asking all the time, always myself, so what should a judge do? Luckily enough, I'm not on the court now. What should my poor colleagues under exactly the situation that you what should they do? And because the idea classified as a debunker idea. Let's go to debunker. It's a bad wind. It will pass. So let's, for the time being, let's not come in conflict. Let's do what they do, what they want us to do. Of course we can score a decision, etc., but even more, let's do it. And not create decisions, not give decisions which inflame the whole situation. With the hope that better times will come. And in my talk with, not with the Israeli judges, in fact I don't talk about it with the judges now in the Supreme Court, because I don't want to influence that, I'm thinking about it. It will be considered here and there. As my intervention is that, for instance. But when I talk with other judges, I say the Yale Global Seminar that you have been there, I raised this question 3 years ago. I said, this is the main question that we judges should talk about, not this stupid subject that you collect there, which is just a seminar for students. The important thing is exactly what should we judges do under those situations. And I said, the bunker doesn't work. It will never work. Because the bad times under this theory will never come again. So we should think about what really judges can do. I raised the possibility of it. I said, I will retire. I will retire. That's your way? Oh, okay, I can do it. I don't have my legions. How many divisions do you have? I don't have divisions. And let me tell you, the court now in Israel doesn't have divisions. The lawyers are quiet. We hope to change it, but the lawyers are quiet. The law professors are quiet. The law professors that are here are quiet. Not from the from this institute, but otherwise are quiet. Everyone is quiet. And the students are quiet. And I think that that's retirement. Of course, I mean, it's not that let the world be destroyed and I'm right. And I agree with you that some flexibility would be made. So in the lecture I gave, I told you that Hitler dreamed in a single lecture. But he was not talking about judges to do, I raised it. So for example, I added another point, which was misunderstood. See, there are many situations in which two judges, you have your opinion, and another judge has another opinion. So in terms of reasonableness, you can say to yourself, look, it seems to be a reasonable dispute. In this respect, in this case, don't defer to other friends, so to speak. You must, see, you must stand on your own decision. So this is kind of the objective reasonableness. There are situations in which you yourself are not sure about it. It's subjective. You yourself are not absolutely sure. Should I go this way or should I go this way? If you are in this kind of dilemma, that's not the time to. So take the other way. But only under this very specific. And Dieter was shocked. He said, what? Come on, you are giving up your views. No, it's only in this in this specific situation. Otherwise, we have to continue professional exactly the same, and then as you said, the same judgment you give in the past, and also to connect it to the past. And these guys don't know the history. They think that everything starts with them. And when you show them that, look, what I'm doing now is exactly what was done in the beginning. But I and the idea that I was doing, using here, we have done it already in the past. In one of my judgments, it was a case in which about this family unification. And the argument was that there is a risk. So I said, look, but we judges all the time give judgments in which there are risk. A democracy is built on risk. I said, look, if we care about human beings so much, as my opponent said, there would be a rule that you cannot drive on public roads more than 20 kilometers per hour. Then you will not have casualties. But we cannot, so we take risks. And I gave them a whole example of different areas of the law in which a democracy takes risks, and therefore they should take also the risk. And in this case, it fits our exact way of thinking. But my friend, it doesn't help. I'm so pessimistic what's going to happen here. Because in addition to what all the right and the shamanistic right, all this, you have in this as a prime minister that has a personal interest. And this personal interest drives everything. And as long as the personal interest cannot be satisfied. In fact, I said to our friends, you know, the best thing for you to do is to make peace with the Palestinians and against the will of his part, etc. And then there will be a statute of clemency to everyone. And you will get a statute of clemency. And the situation is solved.
We have to tell
him. No,
sorry. This is not.
I'm really very, very worried, but I must say what you said was it's the proper lecture that you should have given to us Israelis and which have given to our judges.
Very cool. Very cool. Yeah.
Okay, so if you like.
We concur and no.
So if you would like to respond.
So I agree with Aaron and Dorit said. No, but by the way, to respond to that first, though, there is something to say. And what this means is nothing in what I have said is in any way optimistic. It basically says you can be optimistic, maybe things will work out, maybe they won't. But that's in some sense... That's when you reflect on what you need to do in that role. That's not your business to fundamentally. I don't want to say that in a dogmatic way. There may be certain situations and certain, but generally speaking, this is a wrong way to conceive of the role of the judiciary. And so, in some sense, what Birkenfelder said more generally about democracy is true for courts. Courts can't guarantee and should not think of them as having it in their hand to create the conditions that makes the survival possible. They can just do the best that they can, and then there is politics. If the stakes are high, then that's the domain where the battles need to be fought. First maybe going backwards, then Laura. Is that correct? Nothing that I said was suggested, A, that there is no room for deference. I believe that proportionality and deference are two analytically distinct types of issue. How much deference within the analysis of the justification for acts of public authority within the test. That's, I think, how we should think about it. So it's only internal in the sense that the question of deference arises when courts actually, or other actors, actually ask, is there a justification? So within the actual practice of assessing reasons, there may be a situation where you come up to a point where you say this is really complicated, or there's reasonable debate about this. If it was settled politically in this way, that's how it could be settled. It's not, you know. So I think deference operates with, even though distinct, operates within the normal procedure of judicial review. So when you take up the Hearst case, it is a legitimate question of whether the court in its original decision was appropriate. And I think actually the original decision was correct. It's also true that in Britain the issue hasn't been discussed for a long time, so maybe it's a good thing to have kicked it back to Parliament. But I think the court was right to say, whatever the right solution to how to deal with prisoners might be, discuss it. We should have a parliamentary debate about it. But here, what we can say here is that the result that has been entrenched here now for, 150 years, that's not acceptable. Because that's all the court did. It didn't, at least in its first decision, it just said, you can't disenfranchise prisoners categorically on the grounds that you're currently doing. I don't know what the limit was, but whatever the limit was, this was a violation of rights. I think that was perfectly plausible for the court to do. That still gives Parliament a lot to do. Parliament can now decide on what basis, if any at all, imprisonment should go hand in hand with electoral disenfranchisement, but within a certain framework or within a certain limit. So that's the response to you. Now, Yuval, you are right that the question of judicial survival or the role of courts in an environment where there's a real possibility that the nationalist authoritarian government might be elected out of office is a different one from one where there are at least reasonable expectations that that won't be the case. So we all know, and we know for sure, that Erdogan or Putin don't expect anyone else to follow them until they hand over the baton to somebody they choose, or they die. It's one of the two. Otherwise, they have to be kicked out of office in a
lifetime position.
Yeah, that's right. So they will not cede power. They don't expect to be able to have to cede power as part of ordinary political change. And that's a different environment. That's one where the situation of courts is different than an environment, say, where in the United States, we don't know whether Trump might be reelected the next time. That might well be, but after that, he's out. Or it would be very strange if he believed that he wasn't out after then. So a lot of things would have to happen for that to be plausible. So that makes a difference. But we'd have to talk in detail about what exactly that would be. Samuel Moyne, that's a large topic there. But the question is, if courts were to focus in their jurisprudence on social and economic rights and do things for ordinary people in a straightforward way, then your argument must be that this is something that courts should in principle do, because so far you would have to claim that they neglected that part for no good legal reasons. But you know, that's the relevant question. I mean, I know you have a much more realist political science informed view, but I think the kind of things that went wrong in at least many liberal democracies, I'm more familiar with, I have an account of what went wrong in Europe that helped generate and support the kinds of movements we see now. But those are the issues there are of a structural kind that in part could have been addressed by the judiciary, but not through social and economic rights. So I'm skeptical about social and economic rights as a tool for transformative change with wide popular appeal, but I might be wrong. So I think neither Moyne's criticism of rights is right, nor is his proposal that this is maybe something that courts should be thinking about is plausible.
I have three people on my list. Four. Anna, Laila, Amichai, and Andre, and then Mattias will respond, and I think we'll close.
Oh, thank you. I have to join a line of compliments, so I think that this was very accurate summary of challenges and concerns, but also how we can go out at least helping courts to choose proper strategies. I have many comments, but I think I'm limiting myself to two. I would claim that what we see now, it's not a change of social consensus. It's even harder, because I would call it a new social contract that has been made in some contexts like Poland or Hungary. And this is a trade-off, so contract like a trade-off. Social acceptance, because we have elections. Well, these are elections for European Parliament, so this is a bit different form with a different jurisdiction, if you may call it this way. But we will have elections where, I don't want to be a bad prophet, but we will see a continuation of popular support of the populists. And this new social contract consists of a trade-off because of the feeling of disillusionment for courts as delivers or deliveries of rights. So I would say, because people in Poland for the 30 years of freedom and democracy did not see a deliver of rights through courts, they lost trust in courts as those who enforce rights, and for that reason, those who were neglected and left over due to, well, social and economic reforms, they accept social benefits as this, you know, bounty to, withdraw from the standard acceptance of rule of law, democracy, and human rights as we have them in this liberal liberal model of constitutionalism. So I would say this is this change goes much deeper than just the change of consensus between the major actors. It is going deeper in the social stratas, in those that were, should have been the beneficiaries of the transformation in our region, but have felt simply neglected or left over. So the social contract has changed, and all the institutions, how they work. So basically, separation of powers does not work. Representative function of the parliament does not work as we know it. Constitutional courts are mainly the puppets of the government. So basically, all what we stood on is now demolished. And the another comment I have on proportionality analysis and deference would be, looking again in your marvelous writing on Socratic contestation, if you go deeper into this Platonic dialogues, you see that Socrates had two ways to address the opponent. Once he wanted to destroy the opponent, and sometimes he wanted to teach him a lesson. So there are the two ways where he led the questions in a different way. So if your aim is to destroy the opponent, you had a particular technique. I think that, you know, all professors know that if you ask the questions in a way that they are hard to answer, then you can scrutinize the student in a way that, you know, it's very hard to defend the case. But you can also lead the dialogue in a friendly way, not to destroy the opponent, but to teach him a lesson. So this is perhaps the way that deference can be put in the framework of proportionality analysis. But I also understand that this is within the structure rather than something else, that not even the other side, but within you know, the methods, how we use the tool, and the tool is proportionality analysis. And perhaps the last comment on resignation is a very hard case, because if the court is captured at least in part, like it was the case in Poland, and there are remaining judges who see that they cannot really ethically follow the new rules, the resignation is sometimes not the proper choice. Sometimes standing within this, you know, new environment and even writing the lonely dissenting opinions, just as, you know, a last soldier on the battlefield. You know, these are very difficult moral choices, but from us, you know, from our perspective, just to say resign, it's very easy for those people who in Poland, they kept the office until the end of the term, and the only thing they could do is to write lonely dissenting opinions that did not matter, perhaps the public even did not notice because the hearings were closed. I mean, the hearings were not open to the public. This is a very, you know, heroic position. So difficult choices to make.
Dana?
Quickly, I also very much enjoyed your talk. I think a different version of the same dilemma that you were discussing faces litigants who bring principled litigation before courts, like human rights organizations who have to decide what types of cases to bring before courts and when they should exercise restraint. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts, and maybe off topic, but whether you have any thoughts on whether human rights organizations or other potential litigants who are thinking about whether to bring principled litigation before courts who are under stress, whether they should take that into account as a consideration at all. In other words, should they be wary of pushing the court into a corner on the one hand, or should they, you know, go with the truth the way that they see it?
Thank you very much for your comments. And two questions. First, you seem to describe the courts as passive institutions. There are historical trends, both in the 1950s, and the courts are not part of the trend. They are passive in the sense that they are, once the political trend has happened, there is now a possibility for the courts to act. Sometimes we think of the courts as part of what happened in history. Now, of course, there is a dialogue there, right? And mutual activities. And it's also correct now. So courts are part of what is happening. They are not only affected by what is happening, perhaps you agree. And the second is that I think it was mentioned here a little, and that courts are not unified institutions anymore. So this is also part of what is happening. So therefore, adopting, for example, deference doctrines is not only a way to counter external political pressures, it's also a way to stabilize internal institutional disagreements. So if you can achieve or if you have a majority for a specific judgment, then you might be correct. But what happens if you foresee that in the near future you will be in the minority, a judge will be in the minority? Does this change a little bit the strategy he should use?
I have two quick points. So in essence, I found your argument very convincing, but maybe like on two points, I think maybe some more nuance could be appropriate. So it seemed you had a very stark contrast between business as usual as on the one side, as the kind of the approach that you advocate, and then a kind of this strategic accommodation where you say, maybe with regard to the timing of when a decision made, it's appropriate, but generally courts shouldn't do it, right? So I wonder here, I mean, there are also in many hard constitutional cases, you can decide them one way or another, right? So I'm not talking about clearly illiberal policies, but a kind of hard cases where also constitutional judges that ascribe to the liberal democratic model, they can reasonably agree. So whether in these type of cases you can see that there's also some room of strategic accommodation. And then the second, there's also a distinction should be made regarding the political circumstances in which constitutional courts act. For example, let's take a country where an authoritarian regime has just been established, like Turkey, Hungary, and on the other end, maybe a liberal democracy that is still in place, such as in Israel, but where kind of the court is increasingly contested. So maybe for these two different circumstances, maybe it's not the same approach as appropriate. I can see, for example, that for the Israeli Supreme Court, that it's good advice to, mainly continue doing business as usual, maybe despite of or including some strategic accommodation that goes beyond the issue of timing, but in where an authoritarian system has already been established. There are, for example, also example in South Korea, where kind of the constitutional court for a long time, I think, acted under an authoritarian system, and then a kind of had still a kind of some institutional credibility, and then when a kind of in 89 the political system changed, it kind of could was there as an actor, so that kind of a heroic approach in authoritarian systems can also kind of compromise a kind of a certain limited role that this court can play now and in the future as a mildly constraining influence.
Take it from the back again. It's highly unlikely. I don't know enough about the South Korea story to know whether this is true, but here's a hypothesis that I bet is true. The judges that led, that basically accompanied or sharpened the liberal edge of the constitutional revolution or reform that occurred there, were likely not to have been the same as those who had already spent long terms on the court before that. So there's the shift in practice went in hand with the shift of the personnel to a significant extent. So there are no individual judges who had accommodated for a long time and then all of a sudden woke up from their sleep coming up from the bunker. That sounds a little bit like, I won't go there. So I don't think that happens very often. That's the empirically not very plausible story. Now, is there a difference between, Russia? It goes to Yuval Shani's question also. Isn't the strategic situation, shouldn't you be more nuanced? Whether you're talking about judges, say, in Russia or Turkey on the one hand, and Israel and USA, where not all is lost. In Israel and the United States, there's still genuine democratic culture there that won't go away. That make it worse, but it still there's going to be something meaningful there, and there's always a possibility that things might change. Now, first of all, I'd say the same is true for Turkey, so we shouldn't be too confident that Erdogan really has a control over anything much. And frankly, if one of the things that we should understand about how history works is that even though there are dictators who are out there for 30, 40 years in control of power, it's much more frequent that something happens and all of a sudden someone who's been in power for a long time, out of nowhere, after a very short process, because of something or another, some event in history, just disappears, loses power. So history is significantly more unpredictable than most theories of it would allow, which is why most theories that have a general claim about how history works are not convincing. That's why I'm not sure. The empirics are always so complicated that to make those the predictions about how a regime will shift, make that fundamental for you, how you understand your role as a judge, I think is generally not a good idea. Now, what about hard cases? So the question is how we think of hard cases. Now, Dworkin, I think Ronald Dworkin gets it right. Hard cases are cases where you have to think hard about what the right answer is. And then what you think, you may be wrong, but what you think is the best answer, the right answer in that case. Then the question is, should you just on the ground that there are others who disagree with you? That's one question. That's the question from Amichai, I think. If there are other judges on the there that disagree with you, and let's say that other judges are reasonable people too, there's no reasonable consensus on this issue. But I think, nonetheless, that may be a reason for you, that's certainly a reason for you not to vote with the majority. Maybe you're going to write a dissenting opinion. Maybe you don't want to unnecessarily create friction, and therefore you just remain quiet, or just signal your disagreement without making a big deal out of it. That's normal, that can happen on the court. But what you definitely should not do is feign agreement. I think there's something morally wrong if you pretend that something is justifiable when really once you've thought about it and you came to a conclusion, Now, this is the presupposition. You came to a conclusion. Maybe a hard case, but you came to a conclusion and you think this ought to be struck down. Then you should, in some form or another, you don't have to write a dissent. There's no duty to write a dissent. You can just communicate to your colleagues, try to persuade them, say, okay, I'm outvoted. That's end of story. That's fine. But you should never, whatever the right way of behaving in that context, it should not be influenced by what happens outside of the court, what the political majority is and what the political situation out there is. I think that's, so hard cases can also be hard cases because you've thought hard about them and you couldn't come to a conclusion. That's the situation that that Aaron talked about, and that's of course a situation where if you're not sure after thinking hard about it, maybe you should defer to others who are confident about it.
But those are very rare cases, actually, that you can make a decision.
That's true. Judges are normally the kind of persons that when they start thinking about something, in due course, they become confident about the answer that they want. Yes, they're
maybe
like,
right, I may be wrong, I'm always in doubt.
Yes, but you're not, and that's, we'll continue that conversation. So doubt can have different forms. So
as deference.
Yes. Okay. So I think I also addressed some of your issues. I think Anna, you mostly provided a commentary and highlighted the fact that resignation, that's a complicated issue. And I agree with that, it's a complicated issue. But it also has to be understood that sometimes that's just the right thing to do. Not always.
But this is to give up, actually.
No, to give up on the court. Mm-hmm. Yes, to give up on the court in that context. But not to, you know, then... That resignation in and of itself is probably is meant to be a political act,
maybe they'll be very happy about
it. Maybe. So whether or not to resign, I didn't suggest that there is a moral duty to resign in any categorical sense, unless your role is you see yourself having no choice left within the legal role.
Yes.
To basically legitimize and rationalize, if you can still be the lone dissenter on the court, well, then that's fine, and that's a role that may be a very plausible, and you may even have a duty to play that role, morally speaking. But that's very different from having to sign off on something. If you can't write a dissent, if you can't publish your opinion, there's just going to be a vote. The court says it's fine, you're in the minority, and your name will be on there. And the government will say, look, there are liberals on the court. And, you know, these are things pass. Then that's the type of consolation where maybe your presence there is not going to have any productive function. And all you do is you help legitimize the government's actions. Okay. Activists' perspective. Now, I think activists shouldn't waste their trying to get the courts to do something that they know they won't do. I think it may be plausible for activists to try to push judges to do something I think that there's a much better case for political strategy of being relevant for what activists do than for what judges do. So success, the possibilities of success, the effect of a counterproductive judgment for further litigation, all of these types of things I think are important things to think about from an activist point of view. But it may also sometimes be important to raise an issue.
When you think you have a good chance of winning, but you ask yourself what the ramifications of that win could be for further backlash.
Yes, yes. Yes. So, for example, I would look at this as a timing issue, also for judges. Mm-hmm. So, if an issue now came up in the United States and ultimately went to the Supreme Court, there isn't one that I'm aware of. But if it were the case, involving say transgender in the military, so the view of the Trump administration don't ask, don't tell. I think is the position. It's a case you can.
that has a chance of succeeding, that this is not an adequate policy. But it's with the majority as it is, it could go either way. But it's the type of issue that you can expect to be counterproductive at this particular point. Win this one, and you'll make the Trump faction stronger right now. So I think this is the type of thing where if I was thinking about how to allocate resources as a human rights group, unless of course you are focused on the rights of transgender people, then it's a complicated persuasion. It's a complicated. You have to think. You know, your role is one that maybe doesn't allow that. But if you're a wider human rights organization, then you'd probably allocate your resources wisely by focusing on other things. As a court, it would be the type of case where I'd say, okay, we'll decide that when we come to it, but maybe we'll wait till after the elections, or something like that, something along those lines.
Okay, thank you again for a wonderful lecture.
I wanted to float an idea since we're a small group to feel. We had originally thought that we would allow you guys to go back to the hotel, and then. But I think it's just that borderline time where it just ends up being. So we wanted to propose perhaps that we would proceed directly from here to dinner. Mm-hmm. Is there any immense disagreement or opposition? Do we have to pick up people from the hotel?
Maybe.
Can we arrange that we will have two factions?
5 minutes at the hotel, that would be good, yeah.
The driver can...
Stop at the hotel.
Then you can continue to the restaurant.
Okay.
No problem.
So let's work out, let's take 2 minutes to work out the details.
Yeah.
And then we'll... Okay.